Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Richard Poe, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Away with Words, Part 3, Understanding Grammar for Powerful Communication. Your professor is Michael D.C. Drout. Professor Drought is the William and Elsie Prentice Professor of English at Wheaton College in Norton, Massachusetts, where he chairs the English department and teaches courses in Old and Middle English, Medieval Literature, Chaucer, Fantasy, and Science Fiction. Professor Drought received his Ph.D. in Medieval Literature from Loyola University in 1997. He also holds M.A. degrees from Stanford in Journalism and the University of Missouri-Columbia in English Literature, and a B.A. from Carnegie Mellon. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Away with Words, Part 3. Lecture 1, The Red Panda and the Drought Way. And now, Professor Drought.
When people find out I'm an English professor, the first thing that they ever say is, uh-oh, I better watch my grammar. Now, I think this is kind of ironic because I teach writing and I teach Old English, so I actually do teach my students grammar. But most college courses, most English teaching at the college level doesn't actually teach grammar. So it's interesting that people immediately say, better watch my grammar. And in fact, most of those people who say, oh, you're an English professor, I gotta watch out, they actually have had college courses. So they've had college English. So they know that in college English, we often don't talk about grammar very much. And it's the first thing that people say. They never say, uh-oh, better watch my literary and rhetorical analysis, or uh-oh, better not get confused between dramatic and situational irony, or uh-oh, I don't want to mix up an Old English and Middle English now. And that last one actually really matters to me. But it always comes back to grammar. And this suggests to me that there's some real insecurity about grammar. When there are millions and millions of other things to worry about or to be insecure about, people always talk about their grammar. I mean, think about it. It's perfectly acceptable in most contexts that if someone starts to bring up numbers, math, ratios, and so forth, they can say, it was my understanding that there would be no math. And everybody laughs. We can discuss later if this is a good situation or not. But when it comes to grammar, people say, oh, well, I'm not very good at grammar. People, the most highly educated people I know, say I'm not very good at grammar. People simultaneously expect themselves to make errors and feel bad about it. Errors in grammar are just not what the right people do. And at a certain level, this is absolute nonsense. Because on the one hand, the average person jabbers out thousands and thousands of sentences per day, and millions of sentences per year. And the vast majority, we're talking vast out to two or three decimal places, are flawlessly grammatical. Linguists study these things. They've taped people, they've looked at recordings of people, and they find out that the vast majority of utterances that come out of people's mouths are grammatical. Even people who have bad grammar, because they have learned English as a second language, because they've grown up in a non-standard dialect, they are perfectly grammatical more than 95% of the time, unless they're really at a level of just learning English. You try to get a machine that can produce sentences that come even close to that, and no one can do it. So where is all the angst? Where does it come from? Why do people worry so much about their grammar? Well, there's a simple answer, and there's a complicated one. The simple answer is the whole, I'd better watch my grammar, is a different entity entirely. It's a different phenomenon than what linguists are thinking about when they talk about grammatical competence. Linguists are interested in the remarkable numbers of things that go right all the time. And regular people are much more interested in errors and in avoiding errors. So there's a completely different focus. People don't want to be 95% right. They want to be 100% right. And errors stand out the same way that the one car accident on the side of the road stands out as opposed to the thousands of cars driving past fine with no problem. But that's an oversimplification. the more complex answer to the question, why do people say, I better watch my grammar? Why do they worry about grammar? Why do they have so much angst about grammar? Is that when people say, I'd better watch my grammar, they're not looking at grammatical competence. They're looking at their social relationships. People are interested in the subtleties of grammar because those things mark us out as belonging to particular social groups, educated, not educated, from here, not from here, all of these different situations and separations between people. And they don't want to be on the wrong side of any of these sociocultural barriers. Now, I'm a partially trained linguist. I'm a fully trained scholar of language. So if I split an infinitive, who cares? I have the highest possible rank in terms of education about grammar. So in most situations, I'm just not worried whether or not my speech marks me out as someone who doesn't belong there or someone in the wrong social situation or someone who doesn't deserve to be in this position. I just don't worry about it. Now, I will say, on the other hand, I've never been invited for dinner with the kind of people with really old, old money who endow whole universities. So maybe if I were in that situation, I'd worry about my infinitives or something like that. But I have the benefit of being able to invoke the English professor rule. If I said it, it's grammatically correct enough for me. And so it ought to be grammatically correct enough for you. That's very bogus, by the way. That's misuse of authority. But I can get away with that because I'm an English professor. But for most people, for normal people, for the kind of people who don't read the Reverend Walter Skeet's Principles of English Etymology from cover to cover, I've done that. But for normal people, mastering certain arcane rules of grammar and having enough time and concentration to follow those rules of grammar is a way of separating people from each other. Based on some tiny, tiny subset of usage, whether you put a preposition at the end of a sentence, whether you split an infinitive, whether you dangle a participle, for example, and those aren't actually as important as people think, you can tell who is educated and who's not, even though this isn't entirely true. Now, of course, the use of particular grammar cues is only slightly correlated with actual education and is not at all correlated with intelligence, but people still care about it exactly because it has that social weighting and that cultural effect. Now, I try not to, I think I often succeed, in not worrying about my grammar, but I have the advantage of studying language for a living. And it's not like the same sorts of things don't affect me either, and they're just not related to grammar. For example, if you put me at a fancy dinner party where I'm not allowed to pick up the food with my fingers or wipe my mouth on the tablecloth, all of a sudden, I am worried about certain arbitrary customs, and I have to think, okay, I better watch my manners, I better not dig things out of my teeth with the edge of a business card, and so forth. Humans are exquisitely sensitive about these markers of social rank. And so language is only one of these markers. And so when people say to me, Professor Drought, you're an English professor, I'd better watch my grammar, they're really doing the same thing that I do when I show up at a dinner party and I just happen to mention, you know, I grew up in suburban New Jersey eating Cheese Whiz sandwiches and Dinty Moore beef stew out of a can, so I don't know which fork goes with which particular course. In that situation, besides trying to get a laugh, I'm saying, I know there are rules about this stuff, and I want to show you respect, but I don't actually know what the rules are, so please don't think poorly of me if I don't follow them. And that's exactly what people say when they say, oh, you're an English professor, I better watch my grammar. Unfortunately for me, my idea of saying I'm from suburban New Jersey, you shouldn't pay attention, doesn't work with my wife or with other people. But the trick of saying, you're an English professor, I don't expect to bring my grammar up to your level, does work with me and with many other people. And so if I translate that phrase, it actually means, I know that you, Professor Drought, English professor that you are, might spot deviations from some arbitrary standard in a few aspects of my grammar. That grammar won't be precisely perfect because I haven't studied it as much as you. So by saying, I better watch my grammar, I am preventing you from going, gotcha, when I don't obey all the confusing and complicated social customs surrounding grammar. Amazing I could get that from so few words, huh? That's what English professors do. We interpret so we can make things up sometimes. But so what do we do? On the one hand, we're concerned about our grammar. On the other hand, how do we improve or change it or make it so that we're on the side of the social boundaries that we want to be on, The same way that I guess I could actually bother to go out and learn which particular forks to lift and what manners to have and stuff, and I probably should at some point. Well, there are a couple approaches. And the first of those, I think, is exemplified by a book by Lynn Truss. It was a New York Times bestseller called Eats, Shoots, and Leaves, The Zero Tolerance Approach to Punctuation. In this hysterically funny book, and yeah, really, there's a hysterically funny book about punctuation, Truss proudly defends grammatical sticklers, that is, people who will correct your spin infinitives, dangling participles, and most of all for Truss, your misplaced apostrophes. Truss thinks that traditional correct grammar and pronunciation are something worth preserving, and we should strive to follow whatever correct usage is, and we should learn what it is. Okay, so that's one side. And the other side is exemplified by David Crystal, who has a book called The Fight for English, How the Language Pundits Ate, Shot, and Left. And you can tell that this is a reaction to Truss, obviously, since she took her title. Now, Crystal is an immensely distinguished scholar of linguistics at Oxford, and he sees the sticklers, the people who would correct your grammar in public, the people who would mark off on your memo if you had a split infinitive or if you had a subject-verb agreement problem or something like that, he sees those people as bad, even though he agrees that Lynn Truss is very funny. But he sees those people as bad because they're maintaining class and social boundaries, they're penalizing people from different social or cultural backgrounds, and they're trying to reinscribe, to use his words, all kinds of social, class, and race attitudes that he doesn't like. Now here's the problem, is that Truss and Crystal are talking right past each other, even though they acknowledge each other, they're just completely missing the point of the other one. Crystal goes out of his way to say, oh, I'm not an anything goes kind of guy, though he doesn't really actually give any guidance as to how you should affect or change your grammar or what's bad. And Truss, on the other hand, even though she's like relentlessly mocking things like the use of apostrophe to mark the simple plural or the lack of an apostrophe where it belongs, she actually talks about wanting to walk around with an apostrophe on a stick and go up and hold it up to signs that are missing the apostrophe. But she says she has sympathy for people who find that simple S with no apostrophe on words ending with a vowel looks odd sometimes. And she's right. But again, neither one is really engaging with the other arguments. And even worse, neither one of them gives a sensible approach to changing your own grammar, which is, I assume, the reason that you're listening to this course. Crystal's point that we should accept like a wide variety of usages as grammatical is really nice in some kind of existential way. Like we should be more tolerant, we should be more caring, we should not judge people based on their grammar. And that's great, and I would love to live in that kind of a world, but that's not the kind of world we actually do live in. So if you go and tell people, you know what, from a linguistic point of view, your grammar's flawless, that makes them feel good for like 2 seconds, and then they still say, Professor Drought, you're an English professor, how do I improve my grammar? So you can tell people all they want they don't need to change it, but they want to. And we're not going to change the entire world, so let's change people's individual grammar if they want to. I kind of take Crystal as like the personal trainer at the gym where I go. If the personal trainer said to me, you know, Mike, you should just be happy with your current body shape, not get so worked up about trying to lift weights and change the way you look. I mean, you're not grotesquely overweight or incredibly weak, so it's just basically average. It's fine. I would probably go find another personal trainer. And I think the same thing for a grammar teacher who says, yeah, you're basically good, you're fine, move along, don't judge people, you're all set. Now, unfortunately, Lynn Truss, as funny as she is, isn't particularly helpful. She gives you many, many, many rules for punctuation. She even gets into some of the history behind it, and most of the time she gets it right, but her rules don't really hang together in anything that you can pick up and learn from her book. You just get a lot of good laughs, and I highly recommend the book. My students always love reading it, but they come away with it the way they came away from my 8th grade grammar class. They've got a lot of partially understood rules and a lot of confusion. And so I bring you the Drought way. I'm offering, instead of Truss's stickler approach or Crystal's almost anything goes and just try to be more open-minded approach, something that I think is far more reasonable and effective. I kind of would, wouldn't I? The Drought way. It's a middle ground between let's celebrate grammatical differences and Truss's zero tolerance. On the one hand, Crystal is right. It's an obnoxious power play to, say, correct someone's split infinitive. See, I'm an English professor, so I just split that infinitive and nothing happened to me. But it's really obnoxious to do it and show social superiority. Oh, did you just split an infinitive? On the other hand, you know, life is what it is. Enough people are prejudiced against non-standard grammar that it's worth developing your own grammatical knowledge so that you can switch back and forth between standard and non-standard, between formal and informal, the same way that we do in all kinds of other social situations. And also, then when you run up against these people, these sticklers who really don't know what they're talking about, you can follow the convention, but also you can know what you're talking about and even defend yourself. My analogy is this. In my heart of hearts, I really think elaborate table manners are stupid. I'm sorry, I do. My excuse is that I'm from New Jersey, which isn't fair because other members of my family have lovely table manners. But I really just, deep down inside, don't care which fork I use. There's no existential sorriness in my heart if I pick up the lobster fork and use it on some other type of food. But I recognize that I might want to avoid embarrassing my wife or embarrassing myself or undercutting what I'm trying to accomplish by being at the dinner party in the first place. So I learn some rules. I figure out how, in my wife's words, not to eat like a barbarian. And I even discover that there's a small bit of intellectual elegance in the relationship between the different dining implements and the different kinds of food. I mean, did you realize that they actually are made so that like one fits whatever you're trying to eat? I hadn't really realized that. So the Drought way is this. You learn about the details of grammar. You pick up the, quote, good grammar because it's something incredibly interesting anyway, because it relates to other human beings. And let's face it, other human beings are interesting. They're the most interesting things in the world. But also, you still know deep down inside, this is the other part of the Drought way, you know deep down inside that a grammar error just means that you picked up the wrong fork. It has nothing to do with your intelligence. It has nothing to do with your basic broad-ranging education. And it has nothing to do with whether you're a good person or not. It's simply a custom that you haven't entirely mastered, like a dance step or a new piece of technology. That's all it is. Siphon away all the stress and then learn about grammar for the sheer joy of it. I actually wanted to entitle this course The Joy of Grammar, and maybe we will at some point. Really, learning about grammar is a wonderful, joyful experience. It's a great feeling to understand all of a sudden why the rules are the way they are, to see how modern grammar, the kind that linguists do, explains those arbitrary rules, and to show how that a lot of things in our grammar are there due to history. And that is the second part of the Drought way. We don't go the whole hog on what could be called modern grammar or transformational generative grammar and talk about X-bar syntax and WH movement and identifying things as D structure and S structure and NPs and VPs. And we'll actually explain all that in a later lecture. But we don't ignore all the old school rules and terminology either, because that's what people know. What we do is we use the modern transformational generative grammar to explain the old school rules. Now, the Drought way has a mascot. I represent the Drought way with the red panda. And I've asked my publishers here to sneak a red panda onto the cover of this course. I don't know if they're going to do it or not. But in any event, the red panda is our course mascot. And I have my daughter's Beanie Baby Panda sitting here in the booth with me right now. Let me explain why the red panda is our totem animal for the rest of this course. Well, bizarrely, regular old black and white pandas, Aluropoda melanoleuca, for those who want the scientific name, which means black and white cat foot, actually, have become the mascots of grammar books. And it all goes back to Lynn Truss's book about punctuation. She starts out with this joke. A panda walks into a cafe. He orders a sandwich, eats it, then draws a gun and fires two shots in the air. Why? Asks the confused waiter as the panda makes toward the exit. The panda produces a badly punctuated wildlife manual and tosses it over his shoulder. I'm a panda, he says at the door. Look it up. So the waiter turns to the relevant entry in the wildlife manual, and sure enough, he finds an explanation. Panda, large black and white bear-like mammal, native to China. Eats, shoots, and leaves. I'll be a pedantic professor and explain the joke just to really suck all the life out of it. The panda interpreted eats, shoots, and leaves as eats, then shoots, and then leaves, instead of eats, shoots, and leaves, like bamboo shoots. Yeah, really took the life out of that joke entirely now, and you'll never want to hear it again. But the point is that punctuation matters, right? Because you've given the panda an excuse to run around shooting things. Well, let's leave aside walking, talking, eating in cafes, and so forth. Now, David Crystal's book also has a panda on the cover, though he doesn't have a good panda joke. He just thinks that the critics of English grammar usage, he would never use this, he's too politically correct, but I would call them grammar Nazis. He would say they just ate, shot, and left. Yeah, I couldn't get a laugh out of that either. But for whatever reason, now the panda is the official mascot of grammar books. Truss uses it one way, Crystal's trying to reappropriate the panda. Well, since I am reasonable, and Truss and Crystal are not, though they're both really nice people as far as I can tell, and actually almost everyone who loves grammar turns out to be a nice person. It's a weird thing, as opposed to being kind of a jerk and pointing out things. People who study grammar for a living turn out to be really relaxed about it. But I'm not going to lower myself to engage in panda squabbling. They can keep their ordinary black and white pandas, because I will use the red panda. Here's why. A long time ago, back when I graduated from college in 1990, I went on a trip to the Bronx Zoo with my best friend from college. She's now the Broadway actress Christiane Knoll, but she was just my best friend then. We saw a sign at the Bronx Zoo for the new Himalayan part of the zoo, and it said, "New Red Panda." Well, Christy was really, really excited to see this red panda. She said, "We have to see the red panda. We have to go." I'm like, "Oh, okay." So we had to go on this little monorail that takes you to the Himalaya section, and you can see like a yak and I think snow leopards and other things. So we ended up sitting in the monorail right behind the woman with the microphone who tells people what animals are outside and gives them a little spiel. So we're sitting right up next to this woman. And the monorail comes around a corner. And there, curled up on a tree branch, is the red panda. The tour guide says, "Now if you look to your left, you can see the red panda sleeping in the sun." And so Christy looks to her left, and she sees the red panda sleeping in the sun, and she bursts out, "That's no panda, that's a f***ing raccoon!" This was loud enough for the entire train to hear. And the woman with the microphone practically collapsed into laughter. Because Christy thought we were going to see a panda, like a big black and white bear, that had some kind of special redness about it. A red, pause, panda. But instead, what we were seeing was an entirely different animal that she didn't know about, which is possibly related to the panda, and that is the red panda, Ailurus fulgens, which means shining cat in Latin. And the red panda really does look like a bleeping raccoon. It may even be related to the raccoons. It's a little furry thing with a long tail and kind of a mask on its face. And it looks nothing like a big black and white panda, or even, I guess more exciting, a big black and white panda that was red. So that's where that punchline, "That's no panda, that's a bleeping raccoon," came from. Well, I want you to interpret Christie's punchline in a different way. Well, Lynn Truss says, essentially, grammar's all about being a stickler and learning the rules and sticking to them. And when David Crystal says, it should really be descriptive grammar, and we should learn to be more accepting and we'll let important committees of experts decide for us what right or wrong, I want you to say, "That's no panda, that's a bleeping raccoon." We're not going to take either side. Instead, we're going to take what's good from each side and reject what's stupid from each side, and build our own better approach. And that approach is the Drought way. Now, after I prepared this lecture, I discovered what could be another punchline to the joke. Recent research suggests that the red panda isn't actually a bleeping raccoon, but it's actually a bleeping skunk. I'm not making this up. Phylogenetic analysis suggests that the giant black and white panda is related to bears. Okay, there's a real shocker. It kind of looks like a bear. But that the red panda may actually be the skunk or in the skunk in the weasel family. I now kind of wish I didn't know that because it makes it look like my joke will backfire on me. But I'm just going to try to ignore the fact that the red panda might be a skunk. I'm going to think of it still as a different kind of panda. And I'm pretty sure that this course is not going to be a skunk either, but instead will be a red panda in the best sense of the idea. Because instead of fighting over who really owns the black and white panda, as Truss and Crystal do, we're instead going to find the sensible middle ground. We're going to figure out why English grammar works the way it does, why the rules are what they are, and then we'll decide which rules to follow and when. And then if you ever get into an argument about grammar with someone, and they are telling you that you're wrong because you haven't learned anything, or they're criticizing your split infinitives, you can always just at least confuse them completely by saying, well, that's no panda, that's a bleeping raccoon. So here's how we're going to work through the course then. We've set up the red panda and the drought way. And in our next lecture, we're going to talk about what grammar is. And by that, I mean what linguists think grammar is, and what cognitive psychologists think grammar is, and what English teachers think grammar is. So we're going to work through kind of a definitional explanation of where grammar comes from. And then we're going to move on to why it is the way it is, how English got this way, whatever way this way is. How did English become this grammatical creation, this very complex grammatical creation? What's the history behind English? And then we're going to talk about spelling. You don't think spelling is going to be interesting, but I promise you, spelling is going to be very interesting because we're going to explain why G-H-O-T-I could conceivably spell fish. So we'll work through the kind of history of the English spelling system and why English spelling is a mess. And I'm a big lover of English. Obviously, I study it for a living. I will apologize for or even justify English grammar, but there is no apologies for English spelling. It's a mess. But we're going to figure out how it's a mess and how to work through it. That's then going to set us up for talking about what are called word classes. And these are the different kinds of words that you have. You might remember this from school as nouns and verbs and adjectives and adverbs and so forth. So we'll work through all the different word classes. And after we finish and have mastered all the different word classes, then we're going to move on to talking about pronouns in the noun system. I know that doesn't sound immediately exciting, but it turns out that pronouns are some of the most grammatically and cognitively complicated things in English, which is why children, my son and daughter included, had so much trouble learning pronouns. So we'll spend some time explaining how the pronoun and noun system works, and then we will have three whole lectures on the verb system. And that's actually really compressing it. The English verb system is complicated, and most of, or maybe I'll say the great majority of the things that people worry about in English are related to the verb system. So, first we're going to just talk about good old regular verbs and the problems they create. But then we're going to get where we get our infinitive split, our participles dangled, our modals, and other weird things with verbs, and those are the verbals. And then finally, we'll get to the highly irregular verbs in English. And this is an area in grammar studies where people really have a lot of concerns, and I'll be able to give you some simple rules to clear those concerns up. With all of those things in place, the parts of speech, the pronoun and noun system, the verb systems in place, it will then make sense to talk about subjects and predicates and objects. Oh my! Now we'll talk about subjects and predicates, which is old school and old fashioned. We'll talk about the more modern way of describing them in terms of noun phrases and verb phrases, and we'll see why things like who and whom or he and him become a problem and how to solve them. Then, for lecture 11, we actually do move into what's called modern or contemporary or post-Chomskyan grammar. And this is a section on transformations. It's the most complicated thing in linguistics right now. But when we understand how transformations work, we're going to see exactly where some of the problems in English grammar come from and how to easily solve them. And that brings us to the kind of three concluding chapters for the course. Phrases and clauses are the reasons for pauses. That's my little rhyming title for chapter 12. But we'll talk about how sentences are broken up into phrases and clauses, because that explains then the mysteries of punctuation, where you put commas, where you put semicolons, where you put colons. It's all about phrases and clauses. And that's what we'll also do in lecture 13, which is go through the mysteries of punctuation. And finally, we'll talk about the fight for English. Yeah, for English, not for England. That's how David Crystal entitles his book. Well, he just entitles it The Fight for English. But we're going to conclude by talking about why there is a fight for English, what that fight means, and how to make sure that either your side wins or you're on the winning side of that fight. In the end, you're going to come out of this course knowing more about grammar than 99% of the educated people in the world. And I mean that seriously. Most people, even those who are very confident in their grammar, in their formal grammar, in their formal style, in their writing, and their speaking, don't really know why they do what they do. When you're done with this course, you will know why you do what you do. You will know why we put these words together in the way that we do and why we have some rules, and then you'll be able to decide when to follow the rules and when to break them. So I'm very excited to be moving along and to teaching grammar, and that's what we're going to start in the next lecture by defining what we even mean by what is grammar.
This ends Lecture 1. Away with Words, Part 3, Lecture 2. What is grammar?
So I just managed to do an entire lecture on grammar without ever defining what grammar was. That, by the way, was completely intentional and not ineptitude on my part, Drout said after the fact. But seriously, I could get away with that approach because I knew that you had a pretty good idea of what I meant by grammar, and that if people start talking about grammar, if they say, I better watch my grammar, we all sort of know what we're talking about. Well, I mean, that's nice for casual conversation. That's an easy way to communicate. We talk about grammar, we sort of understand it, but now we sort of need to build up not so much a formal definition, though that's useful also. But we need to build up an understanding of what scholars mean when they're talking about grammar and how it's different from, say, what eighth grade English teachers mean, what regular normal people mean, what linguists mean, what philologists mean, and what cognitive psychologists mean. There's a core there, so don't worry. It's not going to be like a blizzard of 3,000 different definitions. There's a core. But we need to know what different people are getting at so we don't talk past each other when we're talking about grammar. So a few years back, I was doing some research at Oxford, and I was walking around at Oxford. It was off term, so there were no students there. It was very empty and very rainy and very cold. But I was walking around Oxford, and over by Radcliffe Camera in Oxford, that's this beautiful round building, there's a set of doorways that have above them School of X, School of Y, and one of them said School of Grammar. And I made my wife take a picture of me standing inside the archway of the School of Grammar because I love grammar that much. And in fact, I would like to change my name from Professor Michael Drout to Michael Grammaticus. I'm not really making that up. I'm not allowed to do it. And I'm saying this because it goes back to the Middle Ages, actually. And for me, my technical research is on medieval literature. I'm a specialist in Old English. I do work in Middle English and the history of the language. So anything medieval is good for me. But in the Middle Ages, you could get the special last name Grammaticus. And there's a famous writer called Saxo Grammaticus. He's a Danish writer. And if you were named Saxo Grammaticus, or like I would like to be named Michael Grammaticus, that didn't mean really anything besides just Saxo, who could read and write. Grammaticus simply meant you could read and write, and that's an important part that I'll get to in a second. But it didn't mean Saxo, undangler of participles, joiner of infinitives. It just meant Saxo could read and write. But I still wouldn't mind being Michael Grammaticus. Now, why is there that connection to reading and writing? And this is really important to understand about grammar. In the Middle Ages, grammar was all about writing. This is linked even further back to graphein, to draw or write. And so it's coming from Greek into Latin, into the Middle Ages, into English. And in English, in fact, grammar has an association even with magic, believe it or not. The word glamour, now we think of glamorous or Hollywood, but glamour originally meant something somewhat magical or unusual, and that is related to the word grammar. And there is still at Oxford today a master of glamouria, And that's the person whose job is to teach Latin to undergraduates. Actually, by this point at Oxford, it's the person whose job is it to assign graduate students to teach Latin to undergraduates. But nevertheless, I think it'd be pretty cool to be the master of glomery or the master of grammar or Michael Grammaticus. And I'd like to bring back that Grammaticus tag. So in fact, I'm going to ask my producers that instead of putting by Professor Michael D.C. Drout, that they say by Michael Grammaticus on the cover of this course. Okay. I don't think that's going to fly, but I'll still say, please make a note of that. Now, as I just pointed out, grammar is one of those places where the etymology, the history of a word, the back history of a word, is not terribly illuminating. Because what grammar meant to people in ancient Greece, in Rome, and then further into medieval England and the universities all throughout the continent was, could you read and write in Latin? And in the late antique and the classical period, it actually meant, could you read and write in Greek? Because if you couldn't read and write in Greek, well, I mean, you just didn't know anything. And then later on, after Greek dies out in the West for a long time, it was simply, could you read and write in Latin? But that's what being a grammaticus meant. And that's not at all what contemporary scholars mean when they talk about grammar, or even your eighth grade English teacher meant when she talked about grammar. So we had that tradition of Greek and Latin grammar going back, but there was also a different tradition, completely separate, which was going on in India. People don't usually think of this as being part of the grammatical tradition, but it was. In India, there were a lot of sacred texts that were written in the language Sanskrit. And those were preserved and even memorized and transmitted, and scholars studied them even after the language had changed away from Sanskrit. So India had for a very, very long time, and completely separate from the West, a study of ancient languages and how they had changed. There were Indian grammarians who were really doing things that we would now say linguists do hundreds and hundreds of years ago. And they decided that grammar wasn't only about writing, but it was about the way that words were put together and the way that language changed. So there was a convergence of traditions of the ancient Sanskrit grammarians with the development of philology and historical linguistics in the 19th century. And what happened eventually, which I'll describe in more detail later in the course, but just to set it up right now, is that British scholars realized that there was an essential connection between Sanskrit, the ancient language in India, and Greek and Latin and Celtic languages like Irish and Germanic languages like English and German. And when they realized all these languages were related to each other, they started to study how one had changed into the other, and we got what's called comparative philology. And out of that discipline, we eventually got, which I'm not going to go into all the details now, but we eventually got what's now considered linguistics, which is the study of languages. So what happens is you eventually change the meaning of grammatical from just, can I read and write, and can I read and write in such a way that people like what I write or that it's similar to the ancient authorities, to how does language work in the abstract? And this is where we can get a technical definition of grammar started. Technically, grammar is the way in which words are put together in language to express things. And each language has its own grammar. Furthermore, the grammar of the language is a system of arrangements. It's a bunch of rules in that language for communicating meaning. So a remarkable thing about grammars, then, is that for all natural languages, in other words, for things that are not made up like Esperanto or Klingon or Elvish, and there's a really quite large number of invented languages. But skipping those, set those aside because those are not the same. But for all natural languages that people grow up speaking and learn as children without formal instruction, all the grammars are what are mathematically called closed systems. You don't need to go outside the rules of the grammar to find an explanation for the production of all the meaningful statements in that language. Not only that, but all grammar systems from every known language in the world, the most obscure and old and the newest and most evolved and largest, which would turn out to be English, which is probably the most copious language in the world right now with the largest number of words, all of those grammars from the smallest to the largest, can produce an infinite number of grammatical sentences, even though they only have a finite number of words and rules. This is actually quite remarkable, and it's a neat mathematical trick, which I'll explain in a little bit. Now, the other thing to think about when thinking about grammar is to realize that grammar evolved long, long before writing. In fact, there's all these different comparisons. My favorite one is if you think of the history of human language as a calendar, okay? So instead of thousands and thousands and thousands of years or even millions of years, think of it as 12 months. Writing only emerges late in December. All the rest of the back history is before writing. I mean, writing, 5,000 years old, maybe some of the very oldest things, maybe 6,000, and really alphabetic writing, much, much, much more recent. But we still had grammar. And this is really important because almost all the rules of grammar are based on sound rather than on writing. And this is a surprisingly hard idea to get your head around. Because you just said, oh yes, of course, it's based on sound, it's based on how people speak. But think about it, the word grammar itself means writing. So on the one hand, writing, studying writing, how things are put together, let's lay it out on a page, let's look at how the sentences are combined. On the other, all the underlying rules were based on speech. And because we live in a literate age, and some people would say post-literate, but I'm not going there yet, we conceptualize our ideas about grammar in terms of writing. But that's actually wrong. So when I teach students linguistics or historical philology, one of the first things we have to do is to try to get ourselves to thinking of words in terms of sounds rather than in terms of black marks on pieces of paper. Because those little black marks on the pieces of paper are what we have now. We link grammar to that. But that's not where the rules came from. And in fact, there are a few grammatical rules in English that happened after the invention of writing, but the great majority, even in English, and remember, most of the changes in English have happened within the past 1,000 years or 1,500 years, and there's been writing that entire time, and nevertheless, it's still based on sound. So we sort of have to do a double move here. We study things on paper, we look at how they are on paper, then we have to convert them into sound in our heads. We have to think about how the sounds would be pronounced. We have to think about how people would have heard the sounds also. And then we have to go back and think about it in writing again. Now, I think the good fortune of all of this is that I'm doing this for recorded books, and you folks are hearing this now. So we've saved one step. I have to convert everything into sound, but you don't. You can just hear it. And so that actually might make grammar easier to learn, even though grammar's, you know, about writing. By the way, this is what some people mean when they talk about post-literate. Recorded books is a great example of post-literate culture, in that I wrote down the notes for my lectures, and I read things in books for them, and I wrote the course book, and I studied all how the stuff to get together, but now I'm going to produce it orally, and you're going to hear it orally, A-U, oral, and you're going to process it there without the intermediary of the page until you go and look at the course book or read the suggested readings and so forth. So this is post-literate if you get all theoretical, right? Because you're encountering it orally, but it's all done in a literate way. But it's even more post-literate in this sense. I'm not reading a script. My producer won't let me write scripts. I have to improvise from notes. And that's a good thing for the way you want to hear it. And it's the same basic principle, actually, of reality television. People don't like the way people read and act to a script unless you're highly skilled at it, like a really good actor. But if you're talking in notes, then you don't sound like you're reading, and that's the whole point. And that's what post-literate's all about. It's moved from writing, past writing, into something else. And just to kind of conclude this little digression, I'll point out that I spent way more time writing the notes for these lectures and then setting them all up than I do actually recording them or you do listening to them. And this is another kind of fundamental, what's called asymmetry in communication, that it takes a long time to write and a really short time to read. The same thing with anything with the graphic part. On the other hand, we can speak and understand and produce speech just about as fast as we can hear it from someone else. And that's a kind of interesting dynamic to the literate-oral distinction. So again, let's get back to grammar now. A grammar is a set of rules by which we can combine words to produce meanings. Now, that's a great start, except we haven't defined what we mean by words. You think, so what? I know what a word is. But it turns out that there is a huge definitional problem in the word word. And you may have noticed the irony there, that defining a word is a problem, but dictionary definitions are arranged according to words, are made up of words. I mean, Bill Clinton's, that all depends on what the meaning of is nothing compared to the problem of defining a word. But really, I brought that up so I could use the word is 3 times in a grammatical sentence, which I just did. And that grammatical usage of is probably a world record, except that now I just did 4, so maybe that's the world record. Woo! So, no. Just wanted to get lots of is together in a technically grammatical sentence. But let's get back to the main point here. A word is a problem in both a pre-literate society and to some degree in a post-literate society. So that's pretty much most of human existence. Because the boundaries between one word and the next are not nearly as clear in speech as they are in writing. Remember, in writing, we have black marks with white space on either side, so we've got words. But try listening to someone speak in a completely foreign language. You've all done it. You've been somewhere, you've heard people talking at a restaurant, and you have no idea where the word boundaries even are. You just hear sounds flowing together. And that's because acoustically, the boundaries between words are not entirely obvious. In fact, your intuition is surprisingly the right one. I know this in kind of excruciating detail because I run a website called anglosaxonaloud.com where I'm posting the entire Old English poetic records, all 30,000 lines of poetry, 100 lines a day. So it's just about done and they'll all be up there. And every day I record 100 lines or so of poetry in Old English. And then I use a sound editing program to clean up all the mistakes and, you know, the disgusting mouth sounds. Or my favorite one, when just as I was finished recording part of The Seafair, one of those beautiful Anglo-Saxon poems, from the other room, you hear my son going, "Daddy, I did a poop!" And I kind of had to erase that out of there. And when you do sound editing, it turns out the computer gives you a graphical representation of the sound. It's called a sonogram. It's little bars of volume. And a good sound editor can then cut out all the bad things just by highlighting with the mouse and then cutting and pasting. Well, what I discovered was that it's not always easy to cut in between any one word because one word blurs into the next. And I've posted an example of one of these sonograms at the Anglo-Saxon Loud website, and I'm putting one in the course book so you can see what this looks like. But you can see the divisions between some words. There's an actual gap or a pause. But others, there's a big blur, particularly when it's small words like prepositions. So if I say, "I am going to the store," the difference between "to the store" is not something that you can easily cut out. The sounds tend to blur into one another. Now, the point here is that a word, if you don't have writing, is pretty difficult to define. Oral traditional societies.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.